Welcome to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodaw, your host for this live program in which each week I have the privilege of introducing you to a different convert to the Catholic Church and also the task of discussing with them a key issue or theme of their journey home. Let me remind you that you're a very important part of this live program, so please either call or email any questions you would like to pose to tonight's guest. Our theme for this evening is the Eucharist as sacrifice. And our guest is Rosalind Moss, a recent convert to the Catholic Church from Judaism by way of evangelical Protestantism. Welcome, Rosalind, to the program.
Thank you, Mark. It's great to be here.
You know, I'd say this every week. I mean, would you ever have dreamed that here you'd be on Catholic television? I mean, what's a good Jewish girl doing on Catholic television?
Boy, they.
And, you know, both of us, we've come to know each other the last couple of years during the fellowship of the Coming Home Network, sharing our journeys. And tonight our theme is not a necessarily easy one. It's an important one, a powerful one, but a controversial one.
For me, it was great, especially coming from a Jewish background, but also through evangelical Protestantism. Very, very difficult. Not an easy journey, a great and wonderful mystery, but one which our finite minds can hardly grasp. But
it really calls us to be humble. I'm reminded of one of my favorite proverbs that says, trust in the Lord with all your heart, but lean not into your own understanding. And I think about that, we can get awful prideful in our trying to capture the truth. That really involves us kind of letting go of ourselves many times.
I know. Yeah, I think, Marcus, one of the things in all my life, why God ever drew me to himself to begin with, it's 21 years today. It was October.
This is a special day for you.
Yes.
21 years ago today?
Today. I gave my life to Christ first. And I would look at all the people in the world who yet don't know him, and I would say, why me? Why did God draw me to himself? I wasn't searching for him. I did nothing to have him give me the life he has by his grace. And now I say, through 18 years of evangelical Protestantism, evangelical Christianity, why me again? Why such grace that he would bring me into the fullness of his church? I don't know, but I want to live for him forever.
It reminds me that we want our audience to always know that as you've talked about your 18 years in Protestant Christianity, you're very grateful for those years.
Very grateful.
Which brought you to know Jesus.
Yes. Mark is grateful for those years and grateful for the men, the pastors, my mentors, who led me to Christ, who taught me all those years. I will be eternally grateful to them.
Well, why don't you tell us how a good Jewish girl ever became a Christian, let alone Catholic?
We did grow up in a Jewish home. We're kind of conservative. My mom came from an Orthodox Jewish home. My dad, Reform. We grew up middle ground conservative, followed all the traditions, lit the Shabbos candle, sat down to the Passover table. We knew there was a God. We knew that we were his. We had a unique sense of that. Every year we sat down to the Passover. We waited for the Messiah to come. Every year he wasn't there when we opened the door. And we went to bed each year, and we would sing next year in Jerusalem. He didn't come this year. Maybe he'll come next year. And I would go to bed as a little girl, and I would think to myself, is there really a Messiah? Will he really come? And we believed it. It was the only hope the world had. But we got out on our own and into our 20s. My brother David, 2 years older than I, started searching for truth in life to see if we could know that there's really a God. And he came across, in that great search of his, he came across an article. Now, we were in our 30s when he read this article.
And at this time, you really had gone into kind of the dark night of your own lives, right?
We had, into our teens, kind of got out on our own. And David, my brother, really became an atheist at that point. And probably you could have called me an agnostic. I would think maybe there's a God, maybe not. I am because of what is. If there's a God, therefore I am. If there's no God, therefore I am. And my knowledge or lack of it doesn't determine what is, so why know? How is knowing going to make a difference in your life? And I wasn't searching, but David was. And when he came to the conclusion that there was no God, I said, David, how do you know that? You have to know a lot to know there's no God. And But one night we were together, and he had in his search come across an article that said that there was such a thing as Jewish people alive on the face of the earth who believed that Jesus Christ, a name I couldn't pronounce at the time, was the Jewish Messiah. And I will never forget the shock that went through my system, because I knew we were waiting for him, and I knew when he came, he was to set up his literal physical kingdom on the earth. We would be back in Jerusalem. All things would be new. The problems of the world would be solved. And I said to David that night, you mean they, Jewish people, believe that he came? He was here on earth already, and nobody knows that he was here. He didn't make an impact when he came. The world doesn't know. The world hasn't changed. And he left. There'd be nothing. There'd be no hope left. And it was an insanity to me. And I thought at the time, Jewish people are just as entitled to have problems as anybody else. You can be Jewish and have problems, but you can't be Jewish and believe in Jesus. That was in 75, and I went out in 1976 to California and met some of these Jewish so-called believers. In fact, they were Jewish evangelical Protestant believers. Yeah. And they told me not only that they believed that Jesus Christ was the Jewish Messiah, but that he was God.
Which is truly a new concept for a Jew.
If I thought they had a problem, then I knew they had a problem. A man can't be God, and you cannot look on God and live. And I knew, that they were off. But I pursued their neuroses, what I thought. They told me two things. They told me, number one, God is, and you could know that. And I thought to myself, could knowing make a difference in your life? But then they told me that I could know him. And I thought, no, wait a minute. You think, you believe, you don't know him. Yeah. But I thought to myself, what if there's a God and you could know it? Which I thought there was, but what if you could know him? What a mind-boggling concept.
Just stop it for a second, because this is interesting. What do you mean, what did you mean, as you look at it from this Jewish perspective, that a man can't be God, or that you can't look upon God?
You can't look upon God and live. Even Gideon in the Old Testament said, we've seen God, we'll die. You can't look on God. You would, even when Moses, God hid Moses in the cleft of the rock, and his back parts passed by to protect Moses. Yeah. We wouldn't be able to stand before the glory of God, and God is not a man, he's a spirit. I had no understanding of that.
So as the Jews looked forward to their Messiah, they never conceived of the possibility of how we understood Messiah as the Son of God, more as a Davidic king?
More as a prophet, a deliverer from God, but I never understood that he was to be God, that he was to be God. There were many things that happened over a year and a half period, but the night that did it for me, Marcus, I was together with 12 Jewish evangelical Christians, and they explained to me that night, see, I didn't understand the sacrificial system. We, when we sat down to the Passover table, didn't kill a lamb. We had a lamb shank at the table. But I never knew that blood had to be shed for the forgiveness of sin. And what they explained to me that night is that God is a holy God. He cannot look on sin. All of us have sinned. We've come short of the glory of God. And sin separates us eternally from God. And the wages of sin, what we've earned by our sin, is death, they explained to me that night. And they said that because he's a holy God, he cannot look on sin or come into the presence of sin. But because he is a loving God, God in his love, without compromising his holiness, provided a way for us to come back to him. And they told me that when God led the children of Israel out of Egypt, at the foot of Mount Sinai, he had Moses set up an altar, and they took toothpicks and built a little altar on the table for me that night. And they explained how under the sacrificial system, the individual would bring an animal to the altar, a bull, a goat, a lamb, whatever the particular sacrifice required. And if it was a lamb, such as the Passover lamb needed to be, it would be a male, it would be a year old, it would be a perfect animal without blemish, without spot. The individual would come to the altar, and with the animal, and they would place their hand on the head of the animal. It would be an act of identification, the sin passing from that individual onto that little spotless lamb. And that lamb who was innocent, but who symbolically had taken upon the sin of this person, was then slain. And the blood of that little lamb was shed on the altar as an offering to God in payment for our sins. And I thought to myself, why would God put an innocent animal to death for my sin, put me to death? I didn't understand it, but it began to get through to me that sin is no light issue to God. But they explained to me that night that the blood of bulls and goats and lambs could never take away sin, but they were a kippur, a covering, and a sign, nor could they perfect the worshiper. They had to continually offer sacrifices. But they were all a sign to point to the one, they said to me, who would one day come and take upon himself not the sin of a person for a time, but the sin of all men for all time. And with that, they had never gone to the New Testament with me because they knew that I didn't think it was kosher. But with that, they took me to only one verse in the New Testament, and it was John 1:29, when Jesus came, and John the Baptist looked at him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And it shattered me. I couldn't stand, I couldn't talk, I couldn't believe what I was just beginning to grasp. It felt like, I remember then, if you could picture a curtain with little holes and shafts of light coming through the curtain, when they said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world," it was as if they pulled the curtain aside and exposed the whole stage, and I knew it happened. I thought to myself, if one little lamb under the Old Testament sacrificial system could take away upon itself the sin of a person for a time, what could the blood of God's Son do on the cross as he, the Lamb of God, and we, our sins transferred to him, slain for us? My hang-up all that time was, a man can't be God. No man can be God. And for the first time that one night, I realized man cannot be God. But if God is, if God exists, God can become a man. I'm not about to tell him how to be God. I knew it happened. It was a few months after that that I could work through fear and pride and a thousand other things and give my life to this incomparable Lamb who transformed my life overnight.
21 years ago.
21 years ago this day.
Tonight.
7 p.m. 21 years ago, in fact.
That's amazing.
Yes.
That is amazing. The imagery you've just given us is so powerful when we think the imagery of all of our hands on Jesus, all of the sins coming through, and then thinking of his agony in the garden in which he is receiving upon himself. And then there at the cross, all of our sins on him, the bloodless, the holy lamb. But what does he say, even with all the sins that he has on? "Lord, forgive them. Father, forgive them." But what an image of sacrifice, total surrender of sacrifice, that we modern 20th century folks sometimes take a little flippantly.
And don't fully understand.
Don't fully understand.
Nor do I.
None of us do. We're on this journey. Okay, you've become Christian 21 years ago, and during that time you end up going to seminary and all the study, but whatever brought you to consider the Catholic Church?
Well, through those Protestant years, I didn't know that people knew about Christ. If I could have taken a ladder tall enough to get to the moon with a megaphone and told the world of Christ, if you knew me in those days, it didn't matter who you were, if I passed you on the street, I would stop you and I'd say, "Excuse me, do you know there's a God? Do you know you can know him?" The world had to know.
Especially, yeah, given your background, where you had never even... It was totally brand new news
Everything.
To you. That's amazing that you could not have heard.
Or hearing I didn't hear, but right. I don't recall having heard. Yeah. I know that one time I have a cousin, and she was raised in a Jewish home in Brooklyn also, and she had Catholic friends that she went to school with, And they would go to church. And she stopped into a Catholic church with them as a little girl going to elementary school. Yeah. And she learned that the one on the cross was Jewish. And she came home and she said, Ma, he's Jewish. How come we don't believe in him? Wow. And her mother gave the best answer any Jewish mother could give, don't ask. So so she didn't know, and we never knew. But as I went through the evangelical Protestant years, I loved the Lord's Supper. Marcus, it was my favorite, most precious time. And the comparison of the New Covenant to the Old, both were a memorial. The Passover was a deliverance of Israel from their physical redemption, from temporal bondage in Egypt, and the Lord's Supper from spiritual redemption, which was eternal, not temporal. Mm-hmm. There were so many comparisons between the two. The first was for the duration of the Mosaic Law until Christ came, who was its fulfillment. The second, the New Covenant in His blood, until He comes again. There's so much.
Themes.
There's so much. Even the participant of both. The participant in the Passover needed to be circumcised and ceremonially cleansed, and the participant in the Lord's Supper would be circumcised in the heart and cleansed in the blood of the final Passover lamb. So many beautiful things.
So your Jewish background sets you up for some of the themes that are truly central to the Catholic Church.
And wonderful. But so much I didn't know growing up, because, again, I didn't know blood had to be shed.
Was maybe that big moment or theme that kind of opened you up to the Catholic Church?
I detested what I thought was a false religious system. My first Bible study teacher as a Protestant was an ex-Catholic who was taught by an ex-priest, and I learned straight off that the Catholic Church was a false religious system leading many astray. And I strove to rescue people from what I believed was that false religious system, that they might come into a true personal relationship with Christ. And one day, my brother, who had previously had entered the Catholic Church in 1979, gave me a magazine that had an advertisement in it. It was this rock magazine published by Catholic Answers. It had an advertisement in it, full page. It said, Protestant minister becomes Catholic. His name was Scott Hahn. I'd never heard of him before. I thought, I don't care what he called himself. I don't care what he functioned as. I don't care what his title was. He could not have known Christ and had a personal relationship with Christ and then entered the Catholic Church. I thought, well, maybe he became a Christian when he entered the Catholic Church and bought into all of that. But because theologically the background was somewhat similar to mine as an evangelical, I ordered the tape series. I was packing my house to go on staff with an evangelical friend's church in California at the time, listening to those tapes, and standing at my ironing board, Scott Hahn debating a Professor Newson from Westminster Seminary. Each man had a 15-minute conclusion to that two-hour series. And in 15 minutes, Scott Hahn summed up 2,000 years of church history, theology, and said something to the effect, which I'll never forget, these words, that for the one who will look into the claims of the Catholic Church and the Church Fathers and 2,000 years of church history, to that one, he said, will come a holy shock and a glorious amazement, and then to the effect to find out that which he had been fighting and perhaps trying to save people from was the very church that Christ established on earth. And standing there with my ironing board in my hand, I don't think any connection, the only thing that can describe what went through me was the words holy shock. I stood there absolutely paralyzed, thinking, oh no, don't tell me there's any truth to this thing. I couldn't even believe I was thinking it, and I was about to go on staff with the church. What could I do? But the impact was so great that I knew before God I couldn't turn from it. I had to look into it, and that began what turned out to be a five-year compelling, agonizing search into the Catholic Church, which I entered 2.5 years ago.
I know your brother had gone through his atheistic struggles, and himself came into the Catholic Church, which with you was, wait a second, what are you doing? And that part of the struggle was your battles with him.
Yes, we were trying to save each other.
Trying to save each other, but in the midst of that, the iron was purged, you know, in your own soul, and you found the truth of the Catholic faith. Maybe to back up then, as we kind of tiptoe into our subject for tonight, we mentioned at the beginning it's controversial. Yes. Controversial because that so many of our non-Catholic Christian brethren have a real problem with our understanding of the Mass as sacrifice.
Yes.
And maybe to go back a bit, when you were an evangelical, did you see any sacrificial aspects in the Lord's Supper, communion that you celebrated?
You know, I have to say no. It was simply, as we understood it, a memorial to point back to the sacrifice of Christ. But there was no understanding of a current sacrifice or an ongoing sacrifice. In fact, the very first verse I was given to memorize 21 years ago in my Christian life was Romans 12:1. Therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, present yourself a living and holy sacrifice to God, which is your reasonable service of worship, spiritual service of worship. And I didn't quite understand, but I know it's giving God your all, holding nothing back, not holding on to anything of yourself. But the idea of sacrifice, the thing that was most repellent as a Protestant, when I thought of the Catholic understanding, yeah. And of course it was a misunderstanding I had, mm-hmm. was to think that Catholics thought that they would sacrifice Christ at every Mass. That's what I was told. Many times Scott Hahn had repeated a statement of Fulton Bishop Sheen, who said there's not 100 people mm-hmm. who hate the Catholic Church, but millions who hate what they mistakenly think the Catholic Church teaches. Mm-hmm. And part
That's
of my
a powerful statement for people to reflect on.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And that was part of my what I was taught the Catholic Church was not what I found the Catholic Church to be. And the thought that you would re-sacrifice Christ on the altar at Mass was repellent, and it was idolatrous. It was the once for all sacrifice of Calvary. He died once for the sins of the world, never to be repeated. But shall I say, in my journey, I came to understand that it is never to be repeated, and it is the once-for-all sacrifice of Calvary by the unfathomable grace of God made present to us today, who could not be there 2,000 years ago at the foot of the cross. That is, it's the same sacrifice of Calvary, but as a Protestant, I had no understanding of that.
Yeah, this is the Catholic view, and it's important for us to make sure we get that clearly across. A re-presenting of the sacrifice in an unbloody manner. You want to explain that, continue? What does the Church really mean when it says that the Mass is the sacrifice done in this church, in this parish, all around the world, on any given day and on any given Sunday?
You know, I once heard, I think it was Bishop Sheen, I'm not sure, say that if we could present a play, the Christmas play, the story of the Incarnation, and take it all over the world, for the world to see so they knew the truth, if we could take that show on the road, so to speak, we would. And he said, in a sense, that that's what God has done. What happened at a point of time, 2,000 years ago, God has made present through all the world, at every Mass, the very, very sacrifice of Christ, from the beginning of his passion through his resurrection, made present on the altar, re-presented to us, not sacrificed again, in an unbloody manner.
And maybe if you draw the, given the shortness of time, we obviously can't go through every doctrinal apologetic description of this, but encourage the audience to look in the Catechism to see what the Church teaches clearly. And I'll just one comment, just to add what you said. The sacrifice of Christ and the sacrifice of the Eucharist are one single sacrifice. The victim is one and the same now offers through the ministry of priest who then offered himself on the cross. Only the manner of offering is different. In this divine sacrifice, which is celebrated in the Mass, the same Christ who offered himself once in a bloody manner on the altar of the cross is contained and is offered in an unbloody manner. And that comes from Trent. So it's describing what you've just said. It's the same sacrifice. We're not re-crucifying Christ. Right. He's been crucifying. But in the great, loving, charitable grace of God, he allows us to be present.
It's every Protestant hymn that we sang fulfilled. Jesus, lead me near the cross. At the cross where I first saw the light. Shall I say one of my two issues that were so difficult for me from the evangel? I want to say this because there was a very special priest who helped me so tremendously. May I say Father O'Connor, yes. James O'Connor. I had two questions, and I was a rather hostile, fighting evangelical, somewhat 80% fundamentalist. And I went to Father O'Connor one day in my struggle, and I said to him, Father O'Connor, do you know that we evangelicals, we have Christ? He's the indwelling Christ. He lives within us. He said he will never leave us or forsake us. And I said, do you Catholics, do you get him on Sunday? Do you go to church and receive the Eucharist? Do you get Christ? And therefore, do you lose him during the week? I had no understanding. If you have God, God doesn't come in parts. How do you get more of God? How do you receive him on Sunday when you have him? Do you know the reality of the indwelling Christ? And he said, yes, yes, we do. And we have a relationship with him. He is the indwelling Trinity. And he will never leave us or forsake us. Yes. He said, but as in the marital union of a husband and wife, he said, they have a relationship, they have each other, and they love each other, but sometimes they're more aware of that love than others, and sometimes we go about our mundane chores and we're not so aware, or we don't feel our love so much for one another. He said, but in the marital act, he said, there is a sense at that time of incorporation, of reincorporation, of a union, of a total act of self-giving love that is unique to that time. And he said, that is the Eucharist. He said, yes, we have a relationship with Christ. Yes, he lives in us. He said, but in the Eucharist, it is the bridegroom giving to his bride, the beloved giving to his beloved, his spouse, the church, himself, in a total act of self-giving love that is absolutely unique to that time. That is the Eucharist. That also explains the sacramental nature of the church, which was foreign to me, and it was extremely beautiful to me. And I said to him then, shall I?
Yes.
The one more thing that I said, you know, we believe, we evangelical Protestants, we believe that we understand from the scriptures that that Christ died once for all. Yeah. His sacrifice was sufficient. We can't add to it. And so, again, he explained to me that it is sufficient. But yes, we add to it, not because it wasn't sufficient, but because he is love and love receives. Mm. And at that moment, what came into my mind was a mother baking a chocolate cake. She has the ingredients, she's sufficient for the task, but the little girl comes in, her three-year-old daughter comes into the room and she says, Mommy, can I help you with the cake? And her mother says, sure, honey. And so she puts in an egg, she puts in flour, and the mother is totally sufficient for the task. But love receives, and years ago, someone taught me that the ability, in speaking of the love of Christ, that our ability to love is measured by ability to receive. When we love, we're in control, it's easy. To receive is humbling. But Christ couldn't be humbled. He received as freely as he gave, as Mary washed his feet with her hair. And I thought to myself, I put Jesus on the cross. My sins put him on the cross. Would he now, who needs nothing, whose sacrifice was sufficient, would he now receive me into the very sacrifice which I caused? It's a love beyond anything I've ever known. now that I love him, if I could go back 2,000 years and be at the foot of the cross, now that I've come to know him by his grace, and crawl up on the cross with him, truly we are crucified with Christ, would we not do it? And he gives us that very opportunity to love him, join in with his sacrifice, the sacrifice that he paid for us.
What a great gift and grace. I feel like we've just scratched the surface, but time goes so quickly. We'll be back just a moment. Stay with us. We'll receive your questions for this theme and for Rosalind Moss. Thank you. Welcome back. We've been discussing with Rosalind Moss her journey from Judaism through evangelical Protestantism into the Catholic Church, but particularly focusing on the theme of the Eucharist as sacrifice. We'd like to take your calls now, and I think we have a call. Hello.
Hi, Marcus.
What's your name and what's your question?
My name is Doug, and I'm calling from Middletown, New York.
Hello, Doug.
Hi, Rosalind. My question is, I'm a Catholic, and I have a Jewish friend who is very open to discussion about the Catholic faith. I gave him a catechism, and he's willing to read it. But I wanted to know your input on what kind of common ground I could share with him to make him more aware of the beauty and the importance of the Catholic faith.
Good question. Good question. Thank you.
One thing maybe to tell him that the one that has changed your life and given you life is his Jewish Messiah. Even when the High Holy Days come around, the day of Yom Kippur that just passed, to begin to share with him, especially if he's open, the fact that Christ is the one to whom it all pointed, he's our atonement. You know, he might be interested also, it would be, if he knows the Old Testament scriptures, the book of Hebrews is the answer to Leviticus. The book of Hebrews shows that Christ is a better priest than Aaron was, and superior to the Aaronic priesthood, and a better sacrifice, and offers us a better hope and a better country, and so much if he would be open to looking into the New Testament. Also, you might, there are a couple of publications that are compilations of journeys of Jewish people who have entered the Catholic Church. I know The Ingrafting is one, Bread from Heaven. I think Rhonda Chervin has edited a couple of those books. There's an association of Hebrew Catholics that has quite a bit of material as well. Helping Jewish people who are open to come into the Catholic Church as well, and in fact even more, helping Jewish people not sever their heritage from their background when they become Catholics. Marty Barak, I think, is coming out with a new book that might be helpful to Jewish people as well, looking into the Church. Doug, I hope those things are helpful to you as well.
Good. Of course, humility is such an important part of evangelism, always. And sadly enough, we Christian, modern Christians, often forget our Jewish heritage in the Church. I think, as you were describing earlier, the girl talked about, that's Jesus. He's a Jew
cross. That's right. But you know what I think above all? I just thought of it now. What drew me, Doug, what drew me was love. The people that I met 21 years ago had a love, lived a life, had a purpose for living that I didn't have, and that didn't fill my life, couldn't fill the emptiness of my heart, and they did. And they lived in such a way that what they believed was not only worth living for, but I knew for them it was worth dying for. And nothing will draw more than love of God. We love because he first loved us. Your faith, your living your faith, in love without compromising, in loving him, respecting the work of grace of God in his heart, will be a great gift from you to him as well. It was to me.
Thank you, Rosalind. We have another caller. Hello, what's your name and where are you from?
Yes, hello. My name is Michael, and I'm from New Jersey.
Hello, Michael. What's your question this evening?
My question is, I'm actually a convert to Catholicism myself from Evangelical Lutheranism about 15 years ago. And I just wondered if part of the reason why the Protestants downplay the whole idea of sacrifice is because they you know, there's no priesthood, and so therefore they've had to sort of overlook that whole Last Supper episode as a meaningful for us today.
Very good. There's lots of aspects to that. Yeah.
I think so, Michael, too. I know that as an evangelical Protestant, we knew the Matthew 5, that Jesus, when he came, he said, I didn't come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. And yet we live sometimes in our Christian faith as if the priesthood is gone. One day, I just mentioned that it was Yom Kippur, and I was listening to a Yom Kippur service, the highest holy day of the Jewish year. And I was listening to the cantor, to the priest in the synagogue. And he didn't know Christ. But I thought as I listened to that, and it brought back memories of my childhood, I thought to myself, what would it have been in the first century Jewish people that came to believe, because the first Christians were Jews.
Yes, of course.
And I tried to picture that temple service with the priest coming to believe in Christ as the fulfillment of the law, and no longer offering, going to the synagogue, the temple, before it was destroyed, that next Yom Kippur, and offering to God not a lamb from their flock, because he had come to believe in the lamb to which that lamb pointed, and standing before God, who again did not abolish the law, and offering to God the acceptable sacrifice that he alone gave, which was himself. It wasn't abolished. But I think through the years, and especially with the split from the Catholic Church, many, many things were tragically thrown out and distorted.
Yeah.
Through zeal many times, through love for God's honor, but the unfortunate result has come down through today.
And I think this issue of casting out the idea of priesthood and priest affected so many other aspects of the faith. You know, the issue of confession. Actually, Luther himself didn't want to get rid of confession, but when you don't have priests, what do you do here? And so there was a struggle there, which further generations down the road didn't have quite a problem with setting aside all kinds of aspects. And as we've talked about earlier, the confusion that is there in being able to hear what Scripture says about sacrifice in the Mass, or what it says about Jesus is the one-time sacrifice on the cross. The confusion that's there is because we have cast off 1,500, 1,600 years of tradition, and now we from scratch have the Scriptures and try and define what the Lord's Supper is, we're grabbing at straws. And that's one of the sad things that happens outside of authority, the teaching authority of the Church.
Yes. And certainly, as a Protestant evangelical, I would have understood the priesthood of all believers, but not the order of the priesthood within the Church as well.
All right. We have another caller. Hello, what's your name and where are you from?
Hello, my name is Rita. I'm from Pennsylvania.
Hello, Rita.
My request was, maybe you could tell my husband and myself how we can truly believe when we go to the altar to receive the body and blood of Christ. How can we truly believe that it is? We say we believe. We say we know it is. Yet, I came back from receiving communion, and I'm thinking about all different things. And real quickly, up a few years ago, this little old lady was in the first pew, and I was in the second pew, and I went up to communion, and Father says, and the lady was all bent over, and Father says, ask the lady if she would like me to bring communion to her. And I asked her, and she said, oh, no, I didn't go to confession yesterday. Now, I thought that was cute, and I thought she was too scrupulous. I'm thinking now, she probably truly believes it's the body and blood of Christ and can't possibly receive Jesus without completely cleansing herself.
Very good question. I think about that as a convert. It takes a long time. I personally, for what I have believed in my mind, for that to get down to realizing it. And for others that I've known, like Kenneth Howell, who was on a couple weeks ago, that was immediately for him what brought him to the reality of the real presence in the Eucharist. But sometimes it does take a journey for us to move from just mere mental knowledge into our hearts.
It does, Marcus. And like the one who said, I believe, Lord, help my unbelief. In my journey, I would go before the Eucharist, and I would bow in case it was God. And I would say, Lord, forgive me if it's not you. Of course I've come to believe it. But many times, Rita, when I'm in church, when I go to Mass, I realize that I'm dealing with a mystery. And sometimes my heart feels very cold and very distant. Mm-hmm. I've come to believe it's God, and I've come to begin to understand that I cannot trust my feelings, my emotions, my senses. Truth is truth outside of what I experience, outside of what I feel. I've come to believe that the Catholic Church is true, and therefore the Eucharist is the very Christ that we love, who gives himself to us and is to be adored. And I would just say, trust him, believe him, study the scriptures. We need to be fed. We need to have a reason for the hope that's within us. I remember one time someone saying they just couldn't possibly believe, and I said to them, you know what, forget what anyone's told you. Just take the scriptures, sit down with a pencil, go through them, look at the church fathers, you come to your own conclusion. It's a gift, faith to believe.
Yeah, it reminds me of that, the time when the man went to Jesus about healing, and Jesus says, if you believe, you'll be healed. And what did he say? I believe.
Help my unbelief.
Help my unbelief. And that's a prayer that I've had to say when I've knelt before Jesus, that as I struggled, like our caller mentioned, all the other things that were coming in her life as she had just received Jesus, but all of a sudden she's thinking about all. And she made the comment as if all those other things somehow was a sign of her unbelief.
Oh, but it's not. It's a sign of our humanness,
yes.
And it's a sign of our weakness. I just heard recently Father Groeschel was with, I think, a Protestant pastor, and they passed a church, and Father Groeschel crossed himself, and the pastor said, well, what did you just do? And he said, well, I paid respect to our Lord in the tabernacle. The Protestant man said, if I could believe that, I would get down on my knees and never come up again.
Yeah.
He's God. And I know when I go to Mass, wherever my heart is at, sometimes I wish that it would be filled. I pray the prayer of St. Alphonse, grant that I may love thee, Lord, and do with me as thou wilt. But I don't always feel that love, but I believe it's God. And before him, we bow and we love him. Rita, love him and stay strong in your faith and study so that you have a reason for the hope in you, I would say.
Yeah. And maybe reflect on the fact that sometimes we do take what we have all the time for granted and think about those that don't have the privilege because of oppression or would love to have the Eucharist as often as we're able to, but can't. And I think maybe, especially when we find ourselves, and I've struggled with this when I haven't been able to get to confession, but it's just, I don't want to stay back in my pew because someone, what are they going to think? Maybe stay back and experience the Eucharist from our knees, watching others receive it and reflecting on what they're receiving might help us appreciate that. We have another caller. Hello, what's your name and what's your question tonight?
Hello, my name is Steve. I'm from Parma, Ohio. And Rosalind, I sort of have a question for you. I was talking to a friend at work the other day about the Mass, explaining how it is the same sacrifice that Jesus offered on Calvary made present today. When I mentioned except that it's in an unbloody manner, the words unbloody manner sort of confuse my friend, and I didn't know how to explain further if it's the same identical sacrifice, just as if we were there, then why do we say on bloody? It seemed to be a problem there. The second part of my question, if you have time to answer, is we've always understood the Mass as sacrifice and a sacred meal. In years past, it seemed like the emphasis was more on sacrificial, whereas today it's more on the meal part of it. And I just wondered if you could address that also. And thanks very much for being on the show.
Good questions. Very deep questions.
Yes, yes. Marcus, maybe you could help me here too. That it's in an unbloody manner. It's not that Christ is suffering again and again. It's the Christ who has suffered on Calvary being made present through that consecration. And it is at the same time, it's the total, it's not only the Mass does not represent, Marcus, if correct me if you would, but only that moment when Christ was on the cross bleeding. But the entire sacrifice of Calvary, which began at the Last Supper and concluded really with the resurrection. And when the priest holds up the host, which then is Christ, mm-hmm. He is holding up the sacrifice of Calvary, which is efficacious for our salvation because the Christ who died for us is the risen Christ. Mm-hmm. We are saved because he came out of the grave, and it is the risen, glorified Christ that we receive at Mass.
Well, excellent explanation. I think, and I'm certainly no theologian, when I think of what he has just asked, this bloody, the unbloody, the crucifixion almost 2,000 years ago, yet it's present today, I'm brought back to the issue of mystery. I think this mystery aspect is, even as we go back to the issue of the real presence, I mean, there was, let's say, there was a Jewish carpenter that was also God. How can it be? Mm-hmm. There is a wafer, but it's Jesus. How can it be? Mm-hmm. We are touching on great spiritual realities that are so far beyond us that it drives us to our knees. It's not totally abandoning of intellect, but it's an accepting by faith of truth that God has taught us through his church. Mm-hmm. And an unbloody matter is to understand what isn't happening, but yet in the mystery sense is happening in the reality of Christ's mm-hmm. sacrifice for us. Mm-hmm.
I don't know also. I think Michael said also that the emphasis today was more
yes.
on the meal than on the sacrifice.
Yeah.
Is that right? Michael, I don't know that I've sensed that myself being such a new Catholic. I'm so taken in that I could be present at that sacrifice and offer myself up with Christ.
I think in some cases that is what happens. I know when we went through some of our training in coming into the church, there was maybe an overemphasis on the one side of that.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it's in this idea of not being offensive to those that really don't understand that well the sacrificial aspect of the Mass, so rather than offending, we'll emphasize the other aspect. And what we have to be careful of is in recognizing that at times this aspect is emphasized as much more than the other, is to not go on the opposite extreme and forget that yes, this sacrificial meal is a meal.
Mm-hmm.
It is the fellowship, the communion that we share, the one bread around the world. You know, Rosalind, boy, you know, how can we cover this all? But as you've come into the church, how has becoming a Catholic, experiencing the reality of the sacrifice and the Mass from your Judaism to Evangelical, how has it helped you grow closer to your Savior in the Mass?
Marcus, I feel like a 2-year-old. I feel like I've just entered life. And if you had asked me as an evangelical Protestant what I was missing as an evangelical Protestant through 18 years that I loved Christ and wanted to give him all of my life, I would have told you I was missing nothing that I was aware of. But as I think back, there was one thing from the day that I became an evangelical 21 years ago that I was very sensitive to, that I lived with all those years. And for me, at least, maybe because of my background, it was the absence of the reverence for a holy, transcendent God who is also immanent, who is very personal, but who yet is God. And there was a sense, the holiness, the transcendence of God, the majesty of God, in the familiarity of the evangelical expression, that was seen to be lost in much of the worship. And that has been restored to me in the Catholic Church, that I have again the reverence. It's almost, I said this to my brother David, what a unusual thing, because I it's as if God brought me to him so wonderfully 21 years ago, and I but yet I feel like I almost have him back, that I am home, in that he is God, he remains God, and he is transcendent, he is immanent, but he remains God, and there's a holiness. But beyond all that, I've gained all of creation, the communion of the saints, a mother who is a Jewish mother who is mine, all of life.
Rosalind, thank you so much for being with us. What a privilege it has been. Our time is up. But your own journey has strengthened ours. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Marcus.
Stay with us. We'll be back in a moment for a few final thoughts for the journey home. We've been listening as Rosalind Moss described her journey to the Catholic Church from her Jewish roots through evangelical Christianity. We've often been listening as we've discussed this great and powerful doctrine of the Mass and the sacrificial aspect. As we've been reflecting on these things, I'm reminded what a great, great church we have and how powerful these themes are for our lives, a bit beyond us, but yet we're drawn to trust the church that Jesus has given to us, to understand not only the sacrificial aspect of the Mass, but what is to be the sacrificial aspect of our own lives. Jesus is a living sacrifice, and so are we called to be living sacrifices. If you have any questions about this show, all the things we've talked on, I encourage you to call us at 800-664-5110 or email us. We're looking forward to your calls. We're looking forward to being together with you again next week. We're all on a journey of faith. We are never on this journey alone. We follow Christ together, and we lift each other up in prayer as, with the Holy Spirit, we follow him. See you next week. God bless you.